It's 137 Anime Podcast, Red Leaf Retrocast. More Bleach, guys. Part 3 of this sucker.
More Bleach.
Tori?
Fun times.
Tori, you having fun?
I'm here. Yeah. Bleach is fun. Yeah.
I think so.
I'm doing myself.
I'm watching the newest one. It's actually pretty cool.
What do you mean? I heard it shit.
Who's saying it's shit?
People.
These people are nuts. They're nonsense.
I mean, people don't like Bleach, man. They're all haters.
They are haters, much like those haters of Cyberpunk on Netflix. Couldn't be me.
I watched 5 episodes of that.
And?
Like, I wanted to watch more, but I kind of got a flu, and I didn't feel like continuing, but I'll finish the series.
Pretty sure that means you got the flu from watching the Cyberpunk anime on Netflix. That's what I took
That's how that works. Yeah.
That's exactly how that works.
That's how computer virus works, man.
Exactly. Right. You didn't use proper protection.
I've seen that happen in anime. I remember King's Game. They did that.
Oh my god, that's right. That did happen. That was a real thing. Oh no.
The virus has evolved. It is now a computer virus. Okay, and you get affected through your computer. No, that's not how that works.
Yeah, that's exactly how this works.
Yeah, man.
That's not how a computer virus works.
Yeah, you gotta stop licking the USB ports.
Never. I will never stop licking the USB ports.
Oh no, you didn't properly eject it. You're infected.
You ripped out the fucking USB without ejecting it first.
I told you not to do that. Anyways. Yeah, we're doing more Bleach. I do have some...
We are?
Yes.
Oh shit.
The Rescue Arc, episodes 42 through 63. Not bad. I kind of liked it. More thoughts on that later. But first, guys, I've watched more Chainsaw Man.
I can't believe you watch anime, man. Like,
I do, and I did. Okay. So,
yes.
2 weeks ago, Tori and I were talking, and I was very kind of 50-50 on it. Like, okay, there's good action. I don't really get what's going on, really. It's slow. I'm like, okay, maybe it's one of those where I need a few more episodes. Well, we're a few more episodes in now. I think we're 5 in. And I mentioned this in the Discord between you guys, and we're 5 episodes in, and I just go, you know, the show, really good action. The dialogue, pretty atrocious. Like, is this show stupid? Like, I don't get it. Am I crazy? Am I out to lunch here?
Yeah, no, not really.
Not really.
I mean, we're following a stupid guy, so.
Yeah, we're pretty much following an absolutely stupid guy, but, you know, give him the benefit of the doubt because he never had anything good in life.
Okay, yeah. Well, again.
I told my story with Chainsaw Man, like, before. I read 10 chapters. I was like, okay, that's enough. I don't enjoy this. I went back, I actually almost finished the first part.
Okay.
And I can see where people, you know, like it. There's some really interesting things and it's really well drawn.
True.
But that's a little bit of a problem when you're talking about anime. It doesn't matter if it's well drawn, if it's going to get clobbered into the animation.
Well,
I don't think it's really that enjoyable. Hopefully the second part, because I'm pretty sure everyone likes the second part. So hopefully it's more about the end of the first part and the beginning of the second part. But I don't have a strong opinion over Chainsaw Man. It's just it's a fun manga. I honestly don't see why people religiously follow it. But you know, you do what you do, man. I do that for Strike Witch.
We all have our weird niches.
And there he ruined it. He was making so many good points and then he ruined it.
People
like their stupid shows. Look at me. I watch Strike Witches.
Yeah, you were making good points. That's what I'm saying. And then you ruined it at the end by bringing in Strike Witches. I mean, like, and there his credibility went out the window.
There's one scene I want to see in the anime, which is the astronaut scene from the manga. That one is really the coolest, like the coolest part. But like, whatever, it's honestly not very good. So hey, yeah,
well, the thing is, I like the action, I like the art style, I like the character art. Like 9 out of 10 things in the show I like, but then the characters talk, which is kind of an important aspect of watching this media. They start talking, and there's weird shit in the show where things just slow down to a absolute crawl, and okay, for example, here's the example. There's a scene, and it goes on for like 3 minutes, of this one character waking up in the morning, and he's just going through his like fucking morning routine. He's gotta, you know, make some eggs, he makes his coffee, he grinds the beans, pours the hot water over, shows him in the bathroom, he's washing his face, ties his hair, goes out on the porch, opens up a paper, sips the coffee, then he looks over his shoulder, and there's Denji going in. I'm like, what the fuck is happening? Why are we watching all this? Why is this fully animated?
I'm pretty sure the author likes like old American shows, and I'm pretty sure that's just a American Psycho reference.
I mean,
because that's
fine,
the thing in
but...
American Psycho, right? You get the full sequence of the morning sequence for the psycho guy from Christian Bale. And I'm pretty sure it's kind of like an homage to that, but yeah.
Yeah, but there's so a purpose like, behind showing a psychotic killer like just living a normal life. You know, this guy is not a psychotic killer. It was just so weird.
They're fighting fucking demons and people are dying left and right. So I think it qualifies.
In their little world, it's normal.
Yeah, well, not normal, not really. Even I don't know if there's that scene was shown already. But there's like the oldest hunter that is still alive, and he goes like, people in this kind of job, they die early because they're not crazy enough. You motherfuckers are alive because you're a bunch of crazy ass motherfuckers who only enjoy killing and being on the like putting your life on the line. You only survive if you're crazy enough. And so like it, again, I don't have a problem with that. It's just that I just overall, when I sum every single good point, I still don't see. I see a reason why it can be called a good story, even with its flaws. I just don't see the point of the following it has, right?
It does seem weird.
Was it MAPPA who did it?
I think it's MAPPA.
It's a MAPPA show, right?
Yeah.
I honestly as well don't see all the hype MAPPA put out, you know, with the show. I appreciate them doing things different. Because we always should strive for better conditions. Apparently they did like the absolute best on animation conditions and animators' job and hiring process and paying. But like maybe they're utilizing the following to sell the idea, which I also don't mind, but I don't see all the hype. Like, see, we did something better at this. Chainsaw Man is a good show. But that, no, it's kind of average. And then you get, you know, if you're going to get some weird ass studio that's just going to mistreat every single animator to come up with a super banger show and kind of diminish all your efforts. Yeah.
So that's where we've come to. That's what we've come
to.
Yeah.
It's like for like normal, like early Wit Studio, like fucking comes out. It's like, yeah, Mappa did all the thing, but look at Chainsaw Man. But, you know, we got the animators and a weep. And we put them in cages and look, our anime is way better than his, like than theirs. And kind of like, of course, people won't realize that, but I'm the kind of person who realizes those kind of arguments because I'm a lawyer. So, I don't know. It's too fun. I hope people have a lot of fun with Chainsaw Man because it's definitely fun. Some people don't like Denji. Because he's extremely simplistic, but you know, it's the character. He didn't have shit to eat and such. The whole point of the series is little Pochita saying, hey, I want to see you realizing your dreams. And his dreams are uber simple, right?
Yeah, he just wants to touch some boobs,
bro. You got to understand, you got to understand the characters and understand the scenario, but...
Oh, I understand the scenario of wanting to touch boobs when I was like 12. You know,
trying to achieve happiness, man. Never had happiness in life.
You know, no, what do you say? I have happiness right now. I have a brand new house. I bought it all by myself.
you don't have happiness, you have debt. It's a little bit different. Like, maybe once you clear your debt, yeah. I'm talking to someone who has a debt, so you know, I have a student debt, so student loan, I need to still pay for 10 years. So, you know, I cannot say that's happiness. I mean, I have a degree.
What?
But regardless, that's about Chainsaw Man, not our miserable loans and poor choices.
What are you talking about? This is a great, great choice in life I've made. Sure, here I am talking about going to play golf later, and then I'm going to paint the master bedroom and maybe drink some wine later. You know, the finer things in life, Hickey. Yeah. You need to learn these things.
Fucking rich guy over here.
Yeah.
That's all that Patreon money from doing all the wrestling shows. Come on.
Ah, yes.
Nah, of course. I bought the pins for the balls. Yes. Yeah, chill, man. Yeah, it's fun. But what else? Bocchi the Rock is really fun. Should
is
watch it?
It okay? So I've heard about this. Tell me.
It is. Nothing much. It's just main character is an awesome guitarist, but she cannot interact with anyone. She much becomes a malformed blob every single time just of thinking about interacting with people, but she wants to be in a band, so she does it. And it's just these adventures trying to overcome it and become a guitarist, a proper guitarist. It's pretty fun.
Okay.
It's just a lighthearted show.
I mean, on the previous episode, Tori and I just talked about Blue Lock for like 20 minutes.
Blue Lock.
How's that show? I'm not watching it.
It's good. It's good. It's very entertaining.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it is good because the show is good, or is good because it's so dumb that.
Both. Tori, would you say both to that statement? I think I'd say both. It's definitely dumb.
I mean, I still haven't watched more than for the first episode because I've been busy with exams. Like, so I haven't really watched any anime, dude. I literally watched Bleach today. Like, the majority of it. So I haven't really been able to keep up with anything. But, like, I mean, it is definitely over the top and stupid. But like I said, that's the charm of it. That's the entire point of it. Like, it's taking something. Like, it's taking the idea of, like, you know, special training to fucking produce, like, world-class strikers. Yep. And then we make it really fucking stupid by putting an absolutely insane motherfucker in charge of this, and just basically portraying it almost as if it's some sort of death game without the death part. Yeah,
but we don't know that.
at least not yet. We haven't gotten there yet. Maybe it will become a thing. I don't know.
It's just a career death. You.
Oh yeah.
All the knee ligaments, and you're done.
No, it's absolutely a career death, because if you fail Blue Lock, you will never be allowed to get on the national team ever or play football. You are fucking disqualified for life.
No. Goodbye. You can't get on the national team. You can play on just, you know,
world class
teams.
From what I understand, though, it's the football association. It's like, I mean, they can't obviously stop you from playing amateur football, but pretty sure they can stop you from playing professionally in general.
I don't know about that.
Did you end up watching Akiba's Maid War?
Oh yeah, yeah. I that's it right in my fun, weekly rotation. That show is stupid fun.
Did you see the ending to theme that is Anka? Do you realize like the old Japanese Keisetsu or the police movies?
Yeah, they make it. The whole intro is like a straight up Yakuza intro. Like I'm playing one of the games, and then the exit's like an old drama where there's been a bunch of murder and taking place.
Yeah,
it's so over the top. Like the most recent episode was them trying to get an influx of money, and it's they came up with the idea of like a birthday bash kind of situation. And it's Ronko's birthday, and they're like, "How old are you, Tony?" She goes, 36. And they're like, "Oh damn, that's old as fuck." All right. And the whole premise is they go ask another maid cafe's kind of help, an affiliated cafe. And one of the girls has the same birthday, and she's like, "Well, this can't happen. I'm going to have to murder you." And of course, they all get murdered in response. Just it's so dumb. It's great. It's a good show. It's very good. It's one of my favorite of the year. Yeah. It's not something I'd PA binge, works. But I definitely watch week to week. That's a good way to consume that.
Mm-hmm. Also, the second season of Kung Holy finally came out yesterday, but I haven't watched it yet.
I don't even know if I want to bother at this point. It's just, man. It's over, man. It's over. It's too late.
What, the Concole train has left the building?
Yeah. Fuck it, dude. Like, I don't know.
The Concole train bankrupted inside of the building.
Yeah. Oh, did Concole go bankrupt? Is that true?
No.
No.
Contact Collection is from, I think it's from Kadokawa. They won't just go bankrupt, dude.
Yet.
They will actually become every single Japanese company one day would just become part of Kadokawa. And then Kadokawa would become a subsidiary of 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 Sony Entertainment, which is a subsidiary, 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 subsidiary of Sony Pictures Entertainment, I believe is the name. Then it's a subsidiary of Sony. Because that's how Japan works.
Okay. So where does Bushiroad and like Cyber Agent come into play? Just in the mobile game market?
I guess so.
Yeah.
Oh, is it DMM? I think it's DMM. Anyway, it doesn't matter. Concole. Yeah. It's been like 7 years since the first season.
2014, wasn't it?
Oh, wow. 15. That's like 9 years.
Sure. Concole?
That's close to nine. Yeah.
Yeah, 2015. Yeah, 2015.
Oh, 15.
Okay. Almost. Yeah.
That is seven.
Man. Nah.
So, how do you say Yatsura JD? You're really watching it.
So, I like the updated animation and character designs. It's very well done. I think it matches the 80s feel of the show in a modern sense. They've changed up the dialogue a little bit here and there to make it more 2022 and not 1982. You catch my drift?
Yeah.
Why would they do that?
Yeah, why indeed? I'm definitely okay with that approach. It does lead to some even more funny dialogue that's at least timely, because that was one of the tougher things that I went through when I was watching the original. I didn't watch every single episode, but I think I watched like over 200 episodes of it, plus a few movies. The aspect of Ataru's parents just always wishing they never gave birth to him, and they're so disappointed in their parenting. What have they done? They don't deserve this. They're always so like depressed with their son. That's still really funny. That carried over well. They kept a lot of the 80s devices in the show, which I thought was a choice. Like, they still have rotary phones and like a lack of communication. I'm not sure that I don't know how much that translates to 2022 if the show is for kids of today. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So maybe changing simple aspects like that around would be too daunting, or that was just not in the cards. I'm not sure. There's always something when you make. Okay, so when you make a remake of a show, unless you start changing more aspects to it, then why exactly are you remaking it? No.
I mean, it depends, right? Like what they're trying to do. I mean, like, you have, for example, the remake of Dororo, which is a good example of how I think remakes should be done. It's it definitely brings a whole new light to a really old series that works, right? Even today.
Maybe, but it's kind of timeless, Dororo.
It is. But yeah, like, it's content and style of like storytelling is very different in the old one compared
maybe,
to the
right.
new one.
What is that one series that keep being like remade every 5 years, you know, like 10 years?
Gegege no Kitaro, that one?
Yeah, Kitaro.
Maybe it's like close.
Well, Kitaro adapted like every decade, and everything was like an original story, more or less.
I think that is more the point of that one. It's just kind of like a cultural thing that keeps up. It's like Sasa-san in a way, I guess. Same thing. It's like keeps going through the ages, right? But you got that stuff, and I mean, but there's many ways to remix something. Like, one thing that I always appreciate is the remix for Space Battleship Yamato 2199 and so on and so forth. Because what I really like with that is the fact that they kept the old one relevant by basically saying, okay, we're going to adapt the same thing, but we're going to be doing stuff differently, and we're going to be focusing on different things. Which means that, in essence, while it is the same story, the shows are very different.
Right.
You can watch both of them.
Right, so it gives credence and a point to why you're remaking it and why you should probably watch both. And
21, yeah, because 2199 basically focuses on all the things that the original doesn't focus on. it's a nice way of doing things.
Right. Yeah, and I just don't get that same feeling from Urusei Yatsura, and I kind of had this feeling after watching even episode one. I go, okay, this really just feels like the same show, but now in just 2022 animation, which in a way is fine. It's just because I'm like one of three people that watches modern anime still that I've seen the original already, so I'm like, okay, I'm not really... this show isn't for me. It's for people that haven't seen the original. From 40
years
ago.
Pretty much. I assume that at least here, there won't be too many people that watch it, just because, you know, why would they?
I mean, for the purpose, for the people that listen to this podcast, I'm sure they're interested in just a continued kind of...
No, sure. Like, I'm talking in general, right? I've talked to a couple people who have seen it or at least watched an episode or two of it. And the sort of impression I get from them every single time is that they don't like it. They basically all come back to, like, I don't like this. I don't understand why this was popular. Because, I don't know, I guess it doesn't fit anymore.
No, and that's what I'm saying. Like, a lot of the comedy is still the exact same from the early 80s, and that doesn't translate to 2022.
Mm-hmm.
Now,
but disappointed Asian parents always work.
Well... I mean that part is funny.
That is as relevant today as it was back then.
Yeah,
that has never changed.
Yeah, the aspect of Ataru being this kind of creepy pervert guy. We see a lot of those characters in anime from, you know, 20, 30, 40 years ago, And in a way, there's still that trope is still relevant today in modern anime, but it's definitely portrayed way differently. It's just an interesting topic to kind of talk about when a show this old has come back and they're not changing enough of it to make it seem like it's modern.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's like Captain Tsubasa.
Captain Tsubasa, yeah. I think that's a... I think that would be
another one that just kind of came back and it's just like, okay, but why?
Well, it's because it was really popular back then. Like, surely this will make money in the modern era.
I mean, to a certain extent, at least depending on where you are, Captain Tsubasa, even the old one, is still popular some places in the world.
Captain Tsubasa kind of, is extremely popular here.
Yeah, it's got that cult status. It's like, even then, it's like, why bring it back to just be like, okay, it's Captain Tsubasa, but like, modern kind of, almost? It's like, it's a little bit changed, so it feels more like it's not old, but at the same time, it still wants to be, pretend like it is very old. I don't know, basically
I think I'd really be interested in seeing kind of television ratings of that the remake Captain Tsubasa and this Urusei Yatsura. Like, how is it doing in its time slots relative to other anime? Is it performing to expectations? Is it above expectations? That would be super interesting. And I think in my case, it'd be, because obviously it's geared towards, you know, young boys, more or less.
What?
But, yeah, well, I don't know. The Rumiko shows generally go towards also a female audience. But yeah, I mean, that's definitely a television rating interest that I would have to see how much it is translating, because we know it's just stupid popular in the early 80s. That's why they made like a million episodes of it. Is that still relevant today? Are people into it? Or are shows like Spy Family and, I don't know, Chainsaw Man just exploding onto the scene just way more?
I guess the problem with that, though, the problem with like, the television ratings would be like, when does this air? Because that matters a lot
obviously,
for
yeah,
television
context,
ratings in
yeah.
Japan, right? It's like a lot of anime that we know is popular has dog shit TV ratings because it happens in the middle of the night and literally no one watches it.
Well, yeah, it's like a Noi Tamina
show. If they watch it, they bought it when it came out on DVD or Blu-ray.
Yeah, would be like better to go on the Japanese streaming service and take a look. Most likely, it's on Netflix Japan.
That sounds about right, yeah.
All right, so Berlin is still hanging on against Bayern, not Union Hertha, for a Bundesliga update. Shall we move on to Bleach already? Or do we got any other interesting topics?
Nope.
Okay. Oh, hey, that was 27 minutes right there. Let's go. Play in the drop. Man, I made that Bakano drop, and I fucking love it. It's just the kick-ass jazz
totally,
music.
100%.
Yeah.
Yeah, like, jazz music like is always good.
Yeah. I love it. I love what I heard of it, JD.
Okay.
It's so intense, I can feel it with my heart.
Yeah. Do you feel the music in your soul?
I can hear it. Yeah, either that or the psychosis medication is fading away.
Oh, God. Okay, Bleach Season 3, The Rescue Arc, episodes 42 through 63. Only one filler episode on this in this season. It was episode 50. So we got a lot of action, a lot of continuity, a lot of, I would say, Soul Society chaos. The inner workings of chaos. But incompetence is a very good word to describe what's happening in the social
Shinigami
society.
Shinigami, you're so incompetent. The only confident Shinigami decided to become God.
So last we left off, let's see how do we explain this? Let's see. Season one is Ichigo getting his Reaper powers, and Rukia gets arrested in the Soul Society, we'll call it the Afterworld. Then in season two is the object of the journey to rescuing her from execution because she broke some rules, blah, blah, blah. And it ended, season two ended on a cliffhanger of Ichigo just in front of the execution, or the execution chamber quarters where Rukia is being held. He just got out there, and he's been now confronted by Byakuya, Rukia's adopted brother, or no, I said that wrong. The brother of the family that adopted Rukia, and he had the whole purpose of his character in this season, which is important, is he has a tremendous sense of abiding by the law no matter what. And later we find out why he has these conflicting emotions, even though he is this stoic, no emotion showing character at all. And my major takeaway from this season, besides the incompetence of the Soul Society and the inner workings of their chaos, is there's a lot of fucking characters to keep up with during this season.
Oh, yeah.
Like,
oh,
my God. Oh, yeah.
At least they are distinctive enough that even if you don't know their names, you know their roles.
Like, you know their roles, and they're all very distinct characters.
Physically
designs.
Different enough.
Yeah.
Even there's a fucking dog, you know who is who. There's like, no, the blind guy, the crazy guy, the rich guy who abides the law, the guy with the white hair and weak constitution, the womanizer one, the old guy, the old man, you know. You don't need to know the names, but you know kind of the personality based on the appearance, and it's easy to rely on that instead of, oh yeah, I have 20 characters with the same face that evolved any kind of like physical property that distinguish them from others. Like everyone's kind of the same looking.
I mean, that's how I went about it. I was like, okay, there's evil face
the
looking guy.
The heights are different. The hairs are all different. So they're very unique, which helps.
You see that in a lot of other anime, especially shonen, where there's a bunch of characters and a bunch of fights. It's very important to have these distinguishing features. So it's really not important enough to learn the names right away. You'll learn them in time, right?
Mm-hmm.
So when obviously, I thought season one and two did a good job of introducing kind of your most important characters, like Zenpachi. He's fucking awesome. And it's a couple things are really dedicated to Aizen, the guy who gets murdered. And that's a big focal point of the plot and why there's this wacky inner chaos within the Soul Society. So we know who Aizen is. Obviously, we know who Ichigo's team is because the whole part of season one is introducing his crew, his team of five, if you will. And that and now watching this season is very much appreciated because now I know who to pay attention to and why.
Hmm. Now, I mean, like, it's just one of those things which, like, this is why having, like, a sort of strong artist in general is a good thing. And this is something that, not just Bleach, but like I know shonen anime or anime manga sort of likes to try this out a lot because it's like there's usually a lot of characters and sort of having a strong visual design, a sort of a visual identity makes characters easier to separate because when you're dealing with a teenager, ain't no chance they're going to fucking keep up with all of these characters. And I know I'm an adult and I am not keeping up with all of these characters' names. I gave up on that so long ago because I'm just like, they keep fucking throwing more and more and more. Captains, lieutenants, subordinates, this guy, that guy, this one. Yes, I'm just like, I am not keeping up with this. I'm not going to sit there and start taking notes on names.
Yeah. The only generic guy was the fifth seat of the 4th battalion, the medic dude, and that's the joke that he's uber generic looking and has an uber generic name. And then you instantly remember him for being generic and like a background character looking guy.
But yeah, no, I don't know. I think this is just one of the things again with Kubo Titra, where you see like as an illustrator, he definitely knows what he's doing when it comes to character design. Like this is definitely not this didn't happen. This isn't by chance. This is by design. They look the way they do, you know. Not everybody's like, what's his name? Nie? The blame author guy. Not everybody has his issue with. It's like who does the exact opposite. He doesn't give a shit about what they look like. Everyone looks the same.
Oh my god! What about the guy who does
not
fairy
even same
tale?
Face? Yes, he tries to have distinguished features, but they're all based on like this same model that he knows how to draw.
Right.
Nie is kind of different because Nie doesn't give a fuck. Like to him, it's sort of like it's more of like what kind of the personality, what goes into the characters that matters. Because quite frankly, a lot of people kind of look somewhat similar. So he's like, whatever. Most of my characters look basically the same. Deal with it.
Deal with it, bitch.
Deal with it. People don't look that fucking spectacular.
So that was definitely very much appreciated with Bleach. And honestly, I barely kept up with any names outside of the characters that we learned from the previous two seasons. I was like, all right. Immediately we get Yoruichi, the cat from the first two seasons that became a hot tan chick.
Yes. I knew it.
You knew her.
Hell yeah. No, but like I knew that. I knew this was going to happen.
You kidding me?
Yeah, I knew this was going to happen. The moment that Yoruichi was introduced and it's a cat and talking cat and all that, obviously it's like that's part of the joke. Be like, what, you thought I was just a cat? Cats can't talk, idiot. But like, I was like, I knew it was going to be something. Like, this is going to be a woman and they're going to have some scene in like a bath or something where she is going to change forms. Sure enough.
Yeah, man.
Change. Yeah, it's just like, and there it is. I've seen this trope before.
At least it
I
wasn't
remember.
In a bathtub and Ichigo walks in.
It wasn't.
Just, yeah. It
was. No, that happened. We did get that scene too, but that was later.
Yeah, like, can you at least cross your legs?
Why do you take off your pants first?
So. Yoruichi essentially saves Ichigo and runs away from Byakuya because he's strong as fuck. Yeah, that's the plot there.
What? Yeah, no, we didn't know that already.
Yeah. She goes, in 3 days, I will make him strong enough to defeat you. And of course, they go through this wacky dream sequence of fighting his sword person, Zangetsu, and the... I guess moral of that point is defeat him to unlock your Bankai or you die. So it's kind of a similar situation of how he got his Reaper powers back in the first place. And this, to my memory, I think this happens another like 4 or 5 or 6 or 7 times with Ichigo.
Sounds about right. Yeah. No, it's just funny to me because it's like, it's so typical. I'd be like, all right, anyways, unlocking your Bankai is something that's going to take like 10 years of training. Unless we use this thing, in which case you can do it in 3 days.
Or you die.
It's like, or you die, either or.
That's why people don't do it this way, because most die.
Well, yeah, that too. But I don't know, I always find that so funny when it's just like, Oh shit, are we going for a lengthy training session now? Or are we going into some long ass bit? No, we ain't got time for this. This is a shonen. We need to figure out how to do this shit because we need to maintain the fact that this is really difficult to do while simultaneously finding a way to do it really fast.
So while Ichigo's in this state of being, we'll call it that way, the Soul Society is in utter chaos. We got Orihime and Uryu in disguise, dressed as Soul Reapers, to try to get to the jail cell, basically. And then the sequence of events that occurs over the next, 18 episodes? 17, 18 episodes is everyone who's now broken a rule has been arrested. They all get out somehow from various people of going, you know what? I believe you. Get the hell out. Now we're going to fight each other because Ice Sword Dragon Guy, who's short, believes them. Then Zenpachi just wants to fight. So he lets these people out. And it's just a crisscross of events of escaping jail multiple times over in order to fight. And I know that's like a super simplistic way to look at it, but to me, that's just an easy way to recap it. All the way to the last final, I don't know, 5 episodes where we get a big plot twist and a reveal, along with the final encounter, the final quote unquote encounter between Ichigo gaining the extra powers and fighting Byakuya and defeating him with use of the Bankai, but not before succumbing to the hollow powers that they've been teasing since, episode 6?
Yeah. Since regaining the Shinigami powers all the way back in season 1.
Yep.
Episode...
It's early.
14? No.
It's pretty early.
19.
Yeah, with the mask always following him around and that kind of deal. Fighting the ghost person in his mind, which is the hollow that wants to take him over eventually. So what's you guys' takes through the journey, at least, before we reveal the plot twist and up to the Ichigo Byakuya fight?
Aside the training sequence, I think it's pretty good. There's fighting while the training sequence is going with Ichigo, but I think the fights are interesting enough. Byakuya just absolutely destroys Renji. It's not even funny.
You're not on my level, bro. Get out of here. But good job.
Ishida loses the Quincy power using the special kind of like the special ability.
Quincy's out
of just breaking the glove, fighting the captain from the, I think, 12 squad? 12 squad?
Research and development. Whichever one that one was.
Weird clown, clown looking guy.
Yeah.
Weird ass motherfucking.
Nemo, I think is his name.
Mm. I thought it was like Muryu or something. Wasn't it? Isn't that his name?
Whatever.
Yeah. Mighty.
He looks like Yoshimitsu Mighty. From Tekken. That's how I always look at him.
Kind of. Yeah, no. I mean, that entire thing is kind of weird as well, right? Because the same thing, like, how... Like, I know they're being tricked, Ishida and Orihime, but, like, when they're going there in disguise, like, we need to figure out who to call. Like, people are inevitably going to ask us which squad we're from. Which squad are we going to send? Of course, they say squad 11, because... Why not? But like, I love how it's like they get caught by that. They're like, the fucking drunk guy comes out and just like fucking grabs him and be like rips open his thing. He's like, what do you mean it says 12th in this one? I thought that was fucking hilarious just because it's like, you're trying to tell me you fucking took these guys and put on their clothes and you didn't notice the giant fucking thing inside that says which squad it belongs to. Oh my god.
Yeah, and those guys end up just exploding.
That too was weird. Just like kind of, I understand that they want to paint this guy as like a fucking despicable dude. He is bad to the bone. But I thought it was just funny. He's like walks on like, whatever. All of you are waste of time. You couldn't even fucking capture one girl. Can't even do your fucking job. Explode all of you. Just like, bro, come on, man. It's like, did they fucking load bombs into all of them? Or like, what the fuck happened?
He just makes all these fake people and, you know, has a detonation device in them.
Yeah, and he has such he's such a mustache twirler as well, just because it's like, I'm going to kill you, but hold on. I'm going to have to fucking beat up my subordinate real fast and just torture her in front of you for a second and talk shit to her. Because of course I do. This is important.
Does this guy... Okay, this just dawned on me. Does this doctor dude really remind you of the guy from Baccano? With his homunculus? It's the same type of guy, right?
The dude who... The old man?
Yeah, the old man who makes the homunculus. He's got to beat up the subordinate. Yeah. No?
I wouldn't say so. Really. No. I said this guy's way more of a mustache twirler just because at least that guy had a fucking the whole thing. He just wanted to gain knowledge. This guy is just
He wants to gain knowledge, but he's just a kind of a piece of shit.
He doesn't even want to gain knowledge, so he just kind of wants to torture people and be like, I'm testing out a whole bunch of shit on you and yeah, I mean, ultimately it was all a failure because, like, I experimented on Quincy as well and just ended up killing them. Did you learn anything from them? Nah, whatever. Doesn't matter. I don't care.
Yeah.
Why does he want Torihime? Just because he's never seen anyone with her abilities before. Is he going to do anything with it? Nah, he wants to torture her.
Well.
Dissection. And the question was Ishida's grandpa. She's kind of fucked
up. Yeah, I know. Yeah. He was screaming your name. It's like, damn, dude.
Yeah, it's like, this is absolutely pointless. Yeah, like, why do you need to do that? He's just a piece of shit, yeah.
But that's what I mean. That's why I call him a mustache twirler, just because it's literally, his entire thing was just like, who is this guy? Well, he's bad. Yeah, okay, why though? Like, what's his deal? I don't know. We're just going to do everything to make him seem like a bad guy.
He just enjoys it.
Like, no, yeah, I know, okay. But it's like, he's like, he doesn't want to fight Ishida because he just wants to go after Orihime because it's a waste of time. But at the same time, he sure as hell likes taking his time to torture his subordinates for no reason, just because.
Yeah. I mean, it's interesting that a lot of times when it comes down to fiction and character writing, those kind of characters, they're like not well-written because, you know, just like, you cannot just have a guy that for fun goes around torturing people. You know, you gotta make it over the top so it's acceptable. You know, the cruelty makes it more acceptable for a character. The whole thing to be like, yeah, he's a scientist, he does a bunch of drugs and they like testing on people and dissecting living organisms for fun and beating up his subordinate because, you know, fuck that bitch. Like, you know, that's fine. That's cool. I can accept that. Cruelty. Just like sex. It sells a lot.
I don't know about that, but I think sex sells more.
I learned that with Black Lagoon.
Well, that's a little bit different. Those people are just fucked up and in different ways, but they are cool because they at least seems to have some sense of fucking honor, I guess, or some sense of pride. This guy is just like, I am just gonna, like, I'm just ticking off every fucking box in the book of bad guy. Like, yep, pointless violence, unnecessary killing, torture for fun, we're fucking mad scientists, sure, that works too. We got all of these things. Body modifications, I got plenty of those. Don't you worry.
Oh, like, no, my head, it hurts so much. Drugs itself regenerates.
Yeah, that too. Just drugs as well. Fuck it, I'll do it every day. They literally just crossed off everything.
Yeah.
So, there was some moments in that fight, but generally speaking, I don't know, it wasn't a super hype fight for me, all things considered. I was like, yeah, whatever. Kind of just... he kind of just got what was coming to him and then ultimately ended up escaping anyway, so. Woo.
Woo indeed.
So, we get to the final fight with Ichigo and Byakuya. Was this a satisfying conclusion to this fight? Because this whole season, I felt, was getting to this point.
I think it's a good twist on the fight, because, like, there's a bunch of twists left and right. It's just like a ski resort. It's full of twists. Like Byakuya going, oh, this is my extra bunkai when I'm not trying to be defensive, and why not? And you have the holo, the holo powers, and how to use the Getsuga Tensho in bunkai, and why not? But when it comes down to fighting, I think Zaraki Kenpachi against the blind guy is a way better fight.
What's his name? Like Tozu, I think?
Tozen.
Yeah, okay. Tozen. That was close.
Like, that fight is way, way...
way more interesting, yeah, because Tozen can remove 4 out of the 5 senses from his opponent, and Zanpachi is such a beast, he just... all he's left with is feel and his pressure. he can get him anyways. Yeah, it was pretty rad.
Yeah, and you learn a little bit of the motivation of Tozen for something that happens, you know, later in the season.
We do get quite a few backstories of various characters, yeah.
Yeah, it's very interesting. The fight with Ichigo and... it's just that Ichigo Bunkai is kind of underwhelming, I'm gonna lie.
He's just quicker.
And the manga, that fight is extremely cool. One, because it's way more violent. But second, because... The whole fight was colored. I have the issue here.
Oh, I didn't know that about the manga. Okay.
Like the whole fight is actually colored pages.
Well, there is something I've noticed about just to kind of play off that with the ongoing new season of Bleach is it's pretty heavily uncensored. There's a lot of just body parts getting ripped off. Exploding heads and torsos, getting cut in half, and people losing half their brain right in front of them. It's pretty cool. Then when I turn around and watch this one from fucking 17 years ago, I'm just going, damn, I kind of want more blood and gore.
Kind of want more blood and gore. Yeah, I mean, like, a lot of the fights in this one as well, especially, like, it's not even that, like, visually impressive to look at. A lot of it is just, like, swinging sword really fast, doing big sort of wave thing, doing big attack. Some of it is cool, some of it we've seen before, and I kind of agree. It's a little bit underwhelming, like, in terms of how it works out. It has some
jump
cool
attack.
Moments.
Jump
yeah.
attack.
Jump attack, jump attack, jump attack, jump attack. Like, so it's just, and yeah, like, the typical kind of... seen this so many times. I feel like I'm watching fucking Fairy Tale again. It's like, what's the matter? Too fast? Am I too fast for you? Attacks, oh, I'm faster.
Like, yeah. The coolest attacks are the ones, like, they're not as flashy. So, like, Gin with his Shinkai is just extending, right? So he's jumping and attacking a lot, but there's nothing flashy about it. It's way more technical, and it's really cool. Definitely. Like, when he fights Hitsugaya.
Yeah.
And he's like, oh, you dodged I dodged your Shinkai. It's like, I'm not aiming for you.
Yeah. But I do appreciate one thing, though, kind of that comes out of that, like, difference as well for Byakuya and Ichigo. And that was that sort of little thing at the end. There was, like, Byakuya is like, they're ending this with the final big attack, because, of course, he has to. That's how it's going to have to be. I love how fucking just Byakuya just goes all out, fucking utilizing impressive power that you have. Ichigo just goes like, sorry, I don't have any impressive powers to show you. So all I'm going to do is I'm going to put all of my spirit pressure into this one attack. Like, I kind of appreciate that. Like, I don't have that. So I'm just going to have to give it my all, I guess.
I don't have a flashy special move. I just have a swing.
Yeah. I am going to jump in on you.
I'm going to jump at the egg. Yeah, like another rule, like, really cool fight after they save. Okay, that's an important point. The execution starts, and Ichigo already has the bunkai, but he's nowhere to be seen.
Right,
he stops the execution sword, the Phoenix. And then you have like one of the first twists that there's a faction of the Shinigami when this whole thing is going down that feels something is extremely wrong.
Right.
Because a lot of things don't make sense. Why everyone is escaping jail? Like the Hinamori, which is a name, like she's a Kido master, which is basically a magician, right? A magic class Shinigami.
Yep.
Why is she not on a special jail cell? You know, against Kido. Why is she in a normal cell? Of course she's going to escape. Like she's not mentally well, and you put her in a normal cell. They commented that. Like, why is she there? Why is she in that kind of cell?
Well, it's like Renji. He's in this tent, and all he has is his hands tied. He's not, like, actually locked up in anywhere.
Yeah, I know, but like still, right? A lot of the incompetence that we see around, it's like really on the nose.
Yeah, it's weirdly intentional.
There's a faction of the Shinigami. Yeah. there's a faction of the Shinigami that's like something is really wrong. Even the execution, like the penalty for what Rukia did is a little bit too much. And they comment that even in season 2.
Mm.
It's like, why is she getting executed for this? Right?
She got the harshest penalty she could have done for a crime that normally wouldn't warrant such a severe penalty.
Right.
Plus, yeah, the fact that, so then like, you add to that by the fact that normally this sort of execution thing is set in stone, but they keep pushing it forward over and over.
Yeah, and so like there's the upholding the law faction, and then you have like this other faction that's like there's something is going on, and everyone has this suspicion on Gin. But to be fair, Gin is suspicion. He's so suspicious because he goes around taunting everyone.
I'm 100% on the fact that guy was put there simply for the fact that they know that this guy is going to draw all the fucking suspicion on them. This man cannot not be suspicious,
right?
Just by being there, his fucking appearance is suspicious. He's just going to be suspicious no matter what. So everybody's going to be like, this guy's up to something. So perfect way to hide what's going on, because everyone's going to be so focused on this guy.
Have, like the Kitsugaya keeps getting dunked on. Like, poor kid, man. He cannot catch a break. He just wants to be happy with Hinamori, but he keeps getting dunking on. And then like the first twist where Hinamori comes and confronts Kitsugaya and say, you killed the Aizen. You know, I was like, what the fuck? Like, yeah, Aizen wrote that to me. And it's like, there's no way he wrote that. Why would the Aizen, you know, write such a thing that I'm the traitor?
Right.
It's like, oh, wait a second. Like, there's definitely something weird brewing around. And once the execution starts and Ichigo, you know, saves Rukia, you have the Shunsui and like the womanizer guy and the wick guy destroying the sword. You know, and going to fight the squad leader, the squad one, Genryusai. Kenpachi is just going around beating the shit out of people. He just want to fight. He wants to fight Ichigo, and the best way to fight Ichigo again is to help him, so he survives and he can fight again. Then you have like Soifon.
Yeah, she's got the wacky little fingers.
Yeah.
The wacky little fingers.
You heard me.
And it's such a cool fight. Yorichi versus Soifon.
But also that one comes down to not entirely, but a part of that one also goes into that typical shonen thing of I'm faster. No, but I'm faster. No, but I'm faster. And then they decide to throw in the special abilities.
Yeah, it's cool that it ends on a special ability, but it also has its own twist. Because, like, you didn't invent this technique.
Yeah.
It is actually the technique passed down by, like, squad, like the squad leader, Chana, the squad leader on the second squad, the ninja squad, basically.
The assassin squad.
Yeah, but Soifon Shikai. Power is really cool.
Yeah, I do like
if she hits twice in the same spot, it's just insta kill.
Right. I do really like
accuracy.
Bleach.
Yeah, she doesn't have a lot of accuracy, but like, come on, it's Yorichi.
Yeah,
Yorichi's kind of broken. She's kind of OP.
I do like Bleach having this power level, essentially with two levels to the sword and all these enemies. And it does have an interesting element to the fights where you have your Shikai and then your Bankai. And the Bankai is kind of like, all right, I guess we have to use this. It's like going into a boxing match and, all right, rounds 1 through 5, I will not use an uppercut, which is my specialty. I want to see if I can get this guy out with using the most simplistic moves. It's a different way of going about it, but you gotta have. Yeah, I think it makes fighting anime more interesting when you build up.
What do you mean, JD? You gotta go. You gotta roll out right off the gate with a fucking Dempsey roll. What do you mean?
Oh, yeah. Round one, first 5 seconds, Dempsey roll. Let's go.
The engine noises start. The car breaking. Like, oh my god! It was a bunch of Dempsey roll. Yeah, holy shit! Yo, that would be awesome.
It would be. Yeah.
I guess someone busting out that move like immediately in a fight, it's like, oh, I'm facing you, Bankai, boom, we're done.
Just a little
bro,
bit.
Bro, he was only fifth seat.
Spoiler from the next arc, the Arranca arc.
Oh yeah,
that's basically how Ichigo rolls.
Yeah. Okay, so twist time. Yeah. So,
Man, I remember when that, like, when I was reading the manga and I was in high school, I was like, holy shit, what the fuck? Why is Aizen is the coolest character in this, like, by far.
Yeah, so they
far
really,
the coolest character in Bleach.
I thought this twist was built up super well. It wasn't just guy shows up, I'm bad. It was, let's lead these people down to the spot. There's all this tension being built up. Then it's a fight and a reveal and another fight. And it really establishes how much Aizen has manipulated everything behind the scenes, also right in front of him. His Bankai has hypnosis. So everyone's fooled. Yeah. Everyone's under his power except like one person, and that's the guy who's blind. That's just by his choice to follow him. He beats everyone easily, so now we have an uber strong enemy goal that will last a long time. I remember that.
Yeah.
I thought this was done super well, and I really like the enemy. I like the establishment of who Aizen is, why he's betrayed. His motivations are pretty fucking cool as well. He wants to become God, essentially, and gain all these powers of the Soul Society, utilizing Hollows, which plays into Ichigo's story with the Hollow as well. Those well written, well executed. Tori, what do you think?
As a first time watcher of the twist.
Yeah, right.
So, I mean, here's the negative side of coming into something late, right? I've never had anything from Bleach directly spoiled for me, but like, you can't hear about Bleach without hearing about Aizen. So the moment he got killed, I knew immediately. And since they made such a big deal out of saying that he was
fucking dead,
yeah, that would, they made such a big deal. Nope, he is dead. You sure it's not homunculus? Yep, this is the real one. Totally dead, 100%. No chance he survived. He is dead as can be. We will never see him again. We can write him off right now. And I was like, I wish I didn't know, because I love to believe it, but I know you're fucking yanking my chain. So, you know, when he then shows up and it's like, oh, Aizen's alive, and I was like, and there we go, there it is. I figured it was the one behind everything, but yeah, no, I mean, I do agree, it's definitely a cool way of doing it, right? Then, yeah, establishing a strong enemy to deal with, because, like, we've had a lot of strong enemies already, but, you know, Ichigo's catching up, and then what are we going to do now? Well, we need a new strong enemy, and what better thing to do than to introduce a guy who can literally stop pretty much anyone's Bankai with just his finger?
pretty sick.
Yeah. It's like, oh, you're trying to stop me. Whatever, dude. You can't even touch me.
Just slice in half. It's like, oh, it looks like I missed your spine.
Yeah. Like, oh, I missed. I was trying to chop you in half. Oh, you're still conscious? Oh, I'm a suck. That's going to hurt.
Oops.
He's such a badass. Yeah, like the moment when I was reading it, because I'm pretty sure I read this book. No, I watched the anime before. It was before I started reading, but the manga was catching up in my country. So I could like buy the volumes, but I already knew like about the twist. I remember the first time I saw doubting that Aizen was dead when it was Hinamori confronting Hitsugaya. Right? Mm-hmm. I was like, oh, Aizen wrote that you are the traitor. I was like, hold on a second.
Yep.
And they explain like, oh, there's no way someone tampered with that mail. Like, so he actually wrote that. I was like, wait a second, this guy is not dead. I don't know what he did, but like we're talking about magical stuff. He might have pulled a magical shed on everyone. It's like, this guy's not dead. But even nowadays, like rewatching it, I read the manga twice. This is the second time I'm watching the anime. I'm always impressed of how far back Aizen schemes go,
right?
Like how much he knows, and like in this one is like, oh, so you know, you killed the Council of 46 and you've been giving us orders like since the invasion. And Aizen's like, since the invasion? No, I killed those 46 guys like on episode 2 of this story,
right?
I sent you all to capture Lucia, right? I send the penalty for her. I just used my bunkai so everyone could hallucinate they were still alive, but they've been dead for like a good 2-3 months. He's like, holy shit. And then like goes back even further when talking about Rukia's past with the lieutenant that got possessed by the Hollow.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, holy shit, when does like this guy started manipulating everyone, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it always impresses me like how detailed the plan is. And Tosin being the traitor after all the talk about justice he has,
right?
And him being a traitor for Soul Society, it really caught me off guard the first time I saw it.
Yeah, I didn't expect
Gin is Gin. Gin is Gin is like, yeah.
Gin is Gin. Gin is on the side. No way.
I was actually expecting him to not be a traitor.
Same. I was expecting it to be like, this guy's just going to be one of those guys, like, he's just fucking with everyone. He just likes causing chaos. And it's like, oh, he is on his side. Oh, okay. Yeah, no, Tosin being one, that I didn't see coming at all. That was kind of cool. Little ironic, like, I follow the path least dyed in blood. It's like, are you sure about that? There seems to be a lot of blood going on right here.
Good decent amount of blood. Okay. All right. And then the season finishes pretty conclusively setting up our kind of path going forward, where it shows Aizen and the club going to a place the Hollows live called Hueco Mundo. So a lot of Spanish in this show, if you noticed.
Yeah.
And Ichigo and company go back to the human world without really an idea of what's happening.
Hollow related is Spanish.
Yeah.
Mm. You have the Menos Grandes.
Right.
The Hueco Mundo.
Yeah, usually anime has German in it, but in this case, it's a lot of Spanish.
There is German.
There is German. Yeah, I'm not saying there isn't.
Yeah.
But like magic spells and shit.
Japanese, German, and Spanish. Heavily used.
All right, scores. Tori, why don't you go first?
I'll keep my 8, actually.
You're keeping your 8, Hickey?
I'm keeping your 8, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so starting this season, for like I watched like the first 5 episodes or so early, and didn't enjoy that the beginning very much.
Okay.
So I was prepared to actually give it a lower score, but I don't know, with all the twists and everything that happened and sort of a strong finish, I ended up going up from a 7 to an 8. I did enjoy it overall, and it brought itself back in, but like the beginning, the start to this arc was a little like underwhelming. Like the stuff that sort of went down is like wasn't that interesting. The fights that happened, even though it was like, oh, they're gonna have to fight the captain, so that's gonna be interesting. And then it's like, I don't know, the fights are lacking a little bit in my opinion. So yeah, but then sort of second half, more than second half even, sort of after those first 5 episodes, and you start to get into things and you start to realize that something here is off. Something isn't right. This doesn't make any sense. For somebody who's so interested in the loss and how everything works and whatnot, like, they're being very frivolous with how this execution thing is going on. Something isn't right, and then the investigations happens, and the other fights, and the infighting, and the whatnot, and I'm just like, okay, that's more interesting. So yeah, I ended up on an 8.
So if I go back, episode 134 was arc 1. I gave a, Episode 128 was arc 1. I gave a 5. Episode 134 was arc 2. I gave a 6. Now I can say confidently for myself, and what I can recommend people is, how much Bleach should I watch before I'm like into it? And I think conclusively, for my recommendations, I would say you have to watch through to at least arc 3, this episode 63 mark. If you aren't into this build and into the twist at the end and the fights that happen in arc 3 here, then you're probably not going to be into the rest of Bleach, because this is the definitive setup to the rest of the show, that if you're into it, you're going to be into the rest of the show here. So I'm going 8. I thought this was done pretty phenomenally with a lot of the setup and tension, and now you have the big bad enemy. This is the shonen, like, clutch, where you're going to be watching this for the long term right here, or you're just going to be out altogether. So 63 episodes in, I'm into it. I'm like, I like the show. This is where I became a Bleach fan. 8 out of 10.
Mm-hmm. Aizen is just so good.
Yeah.
Like, he's such a strong character. On how he can move the story, even when he's not there, he's not doing anything, and he can still influence the story so much.
Right, and they establish the crew, the club, that will be a big team to go against in the future. It's good stuff. All right, guys, our next episode is Mononoke. Take his pick.
Yeah. I've never watched that show. It's on the plan to watch list.
All right.
Woo!
Getting one off your list there. Good.
Yeah.
Looking forward to it. All right, guys. This was episode 137, Bleach Rescue Arc. See you next time.
Peace.
Goodbye.